Hi there. My name is Aaron Lantraman. I'm a professor of electrical and computer engineering at Georgia Tech, and this is my quarantine hair. And I would like to welcome you to ECE 3084, Signals and Systems. Suppose we have a linear time invariant system with a system function, aka transfer function H1 of S, and we have another such system with transfer function H2 of S. Let's denote the output of H1 of S as YT. And we're going to do something a little strange with H2. What we're going to do is we're going to take the output of H1 and actually make that the input of H2. So the input of the whole thing, X of T, doesn't go into H1 directly. It's going to go into this little summer unit. And the output of that summer unit is what goes into H1. And what else are we doing with this summing node? Well, we're going to take the output of H2 and put that into the summing node. But for our purposes, we're going to have one very important difference, which is we're going to have a big minus sign here next to the H2 input into the summing node to indicate that we're actually using negative feedback. Negative feedback is an immensely powerful tool. It shows up in every engineering discipline, not just electrical engineering. Now, when writing block diagrams like this, it's traditional to take the functions that are on the lines, the signals, and write them in the time domain. Of course, we could represent these in the Laplace domain, and in fact, that's what we're going to do in the equations. Just as it's traditional to represent the signals in the time domain, it's traditional to express the systems in terms of their transfer functions. But of course, we know that these could just as easily be represented in terms of their impulse responses. So let's look at the output in the Laplace domain. We would have the system function of our feed-forward system, this H1S, times the input to the system, which will consist of big X of S minus the output of H2. And what's the output of H2? Well, that's going to be the input to the feedback system, which is Y of S times the transfer function of the feedback system. So we'll have YS on the left-hand side, and let's move everything with YS over to the left-hand side. So when we do that, the minus here turns into a plus, and I'll have plus YS. Now, what am I multiplying by YS? Well, I'll have H2S, but also when I multiply this through, I'll have an H1S. So I'll have H1S, H2S. And then on the right-hand side, I'll have H1S times X of S. So on the left, we can factor out YS and write this thing as equal to H1S big X S all over the stuff we factored the YS out of. So that's going to be 1 plus H1S, H2S. And this important formula is known as Black's feedback formula, and we're going to use this extensively throughout most of the rest of the course. Now, of course, you could turn this minus sign into a plus sign in order to get positive feedback. If you did that, you would turn this to a plus, you would turn this into a minus, and you would turn this into a minus. And positive feedback does have its uses, but the kinds of problems you solve with positive feedback, the kinds of systems you build with it, are very, very different than the kinds of problems you solve and the systems you build with negative feedback. For most of the main part of this course, we'll be dealing with negative feedback, and we'll leave discussions of positive feedback for other occasions. I'd like to show you an example from electronic music, namely the Buchla 191 sharp cutoff filter. The 191 consists of a low-pass filter and a high-pass filter. Each filter is a four-pole filter where each of the four poles is identical. Basically, you have a cascade of four identical one-pole stages. One of the high-pass stages is basically a bog-standard RC filter, except the resistor is replaced by a couple of diodes. And by changing a bias current that's flowing through the diodes, you can change the effective dynamic resistance of those diodes. That's all beyond the scope of what we're talking about in 3084. I'm just giving that to you for context. That's how Buchla achieves voltage control of the cutoff of one of these one-pole high-pass filter stages. And I should emphasize, for those who want to dig into this in more detail, this is a very heavy oversimplification. And to create one of the low-pass stages, what he does is he'll take one of the one-pole high-pass filters and he'll put it in a feedback loop. Essentially, what he does here is he sets H1 of S equal to 1. Let me approximate the high-pass filter as having a transfer function of 15S over S plus omega C, where omega C is the half-power cutoff point of one of the four stages of the high-pass filter. So the high-pass filter itself has a gain of 0 at DC, and it will have a gain of 15 at an ideal infinite frequency. So in this particular case, H1 is basically a straight line. H1 is 1, so I can just erase the H1s. And for H2, I could write 15S over S plus omega C. Let's see, let me try to make this look more like a 5, and this look more like an omega. All right, so simplifying this, I could write this as big X of S times S plus omega C. So I'm multiplying the numerator and denominator by S plus omega C. This is a kind of pattern that you're going to see a lot of examples of over the next several lectures, over S plus omega C. That comes from multiplying 1 times S plus omega C. And then when I multiply this particular term here by S plus omega C, the S plus omega C and the numerator and denominator cancel, and I have plus 15S left. Let me make some room here. So I could write XS S plus omega C over 16S plus omega C. So let me call this here big HCL, which is our closed loop transfer function. And if I were to take this and evaluate it at S equals J omega, and then evaluate at omega equals 0, I can get the value of the transfer function at DC, which is going to be omega C over omega C, which is going to be at 1. And if I do the same thing, but I let omega go to infinity, and I'm hand-waving this a bit, which is why I'm putting infinity in quotes, well, as S goes to infinity in the numerator and the denominator, the omega C's wind up getting swamped, and I wind up with basically J omega over 16 J omega. And as that goes to infinity, that will give me 1 over 16. So the one-pole low-pass filter stages aren't really strict low-pass filters. It will go from 1 at DC and then slope down, and then it will asymptote at 1 over 16. So it's strictly speaking a shelving filter. Now notice that if we were to increase this number 15, we could decrease this number here and force that in the limit to be closer to 0, making it more of a pure low-pass filter form.